Jesus, draw me ever nearer as I labor through the storm. You have called me to this passage, and I'll follow.
Yeah. vision. Our vision is CAST, Community, Attitude, Serving, and Teaching. But you have to have a vehicle. You have to have a way to get there. And our vehicle, our way there is going to be what we're going to call the movement. The reason why we call it the movement is because our hope and our ambition is to get as many people plugged into this as we possibly can to join together so that everybody in the church and both services can head in the right direction, can head in the same direction. I want you to be a part of it. I want to first to invite you to be a part of it. Some of you have already invited. Others of you, we want you to be a part of our church. We want you to be a part of what's going on here. Before I get started, though, I do want to stress to you that I firmly believe today and during this service that the Holy Spirit will move. And it will move within us. And I would like to encourage you, no matter age, background, if you're Christian, non-Christian, whatever, I wanted you to encourage you to allow Him into your heart so that He can do amazing work through you. The central theme of today's message is caring more. We care more. We care more stands for the fact that we as a church care for you. I, as a minister, I care for you very much. I care for you and your family. At any point in time, I've been praying specifically for you and your family, just that Christ can work in an amazing way in your life. I want to continue to do that. But we also should care about our church. We should care about the Lord's church, most importantly. And we should care about those who need Christ. I want to start with chapter 10, verse 47. Of Mark, and I want to start with that because this is a very interesting passage that Christ has this encounter with Bartimaeus. Well, let's start with verse 47. It says this: when he had heard that Jesus the Nazarene, he began to cry out, "Son of David, Jesus, have mercy on me." Many people told him to keep quiet, but he was crying out all the more, "Have mercy on me, Son of David." Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." So they called the blind man and said to him, "Have courage, get up, he's calling for you." He threw off his coat, jumped up, and came to Jesus. Then Jesus answered, "What do you want me to do for you?" "Rabboni," the blind man told him, "I want to see." "Go your way," Jesus told him, "your faith has healed you." Immediately he could see and begin to follow him on his road. This is kind of a neat picture. I want to help you picture it with me, if you will. Jesus is teaching, and when Jesus taught, everybody was glued to every word he had. Not only was he one that was entertaining in a sense, but his words were so important. So they're taking notes of his words, and they're hanging on every word. It's this intense, awesome moment that the Holy Spirit was definitely leading him in. And everybody was a part of it. Everybody was learning, and it was just this beautiful thing that this crowd was hanging on Jesus' every word. But let's be honest. When you're in the crowd and you're listening to a sermon and the phone goes off, and if that has ever happened to you, I'm not pointing you out. But the phone goes off, it's distracting. I'll never forget one day I was preaching and this phone kept going off. And it kept going off. I'm thinking, what? Will somebody please turn off their phone? I mean, this is the worship time. This is time where we learn from straight from the Bible. And I'm getting kind of testing with whatever's going on because I keep hearing this ringtone. And wasn't really paying that close attention. I was trying to keep my cool, but it just keeps ringing. And it's bothering everybody, I can tell. So at the end of church, I'm telling Christy about it, and I get my phone out, and guess who had 2 missed calls. So I had a good stern talk with myself, and I turn it off now. I just don't want to even risk it. So if you imagine this intense moment, this intense message, everything is going really good, and the crowd is entered into it, and packed out, and it's this really cool event, and you hear this guy in the street, because Jesus taught outside, just yelling at him. I mean, if you can imagine me being up here and somebody in the back saying, "Anthony, Anthony, hey, hey." That's going to be distracting. That's exactly what this guy was doing. Jesus was teaching, and he was raising his hand in the back saying, Jesus, Jesus, stop what you're doing. Come see me. But does Jesus get on to him? And he has a great reason for yelling at Jesus. He is blind. And this is before people took care of blind people. So he still, being blind, had to earn a living. And his living was being a beggar. So he's on the roadside, begging for a living. And I'm sure people walk by with judgment all the time for this guy. But let's face it, what else could he do? This is before the time that, you know, the government is able to help out with disability and so on and so forth. So he didn't have that as an option. So what was he going to do? But beg. But he heard this miracle worker, this Jesus, and that's who he's crying out for. Now, this isn't the first blind person that Jesus had ever dealt with. He dealt with a lot of spiritually blind people. Sure, their eyes were fine and they could see physically, but they were spiritually blind. These are the religious leaders who thought they were already saved and were waiting for the Messiah, but couldn't see right in front of them that that's who Jesus was. They were spiritually blind. Last week, we talked about his own family, Mary and his brothers, half-brothers, who they were also blind to what Jesus' ministry is. They were trying to calm him down, get him back in line, as they were told. So this is a fascinating point that he was reaching out constantly to the spiritually blind. And there would be people in that crowd that would be spiritually blind as well. Skeptics, those who are trying to find fault with Jesus and trying to figure out what to believe and what not to believe. But Jesus tried to show them the truth. Yet, and kind of a little bit of an irony here, the one who is physically blind sees Jesus clearly. He sees the fact that Jesus is the one that can heal him. The only means of survival for this man is the passing generosity of people he constantly bothered. But now Jesus had the answer. Barnabas had not seen Jesus' response or Jesus' miracles, but he was responding out of faith in what he had heard. We have heard about Christ. Our entire life we have heard about Christ. And there may have been a period of time where we didn't believe it. And now that there's a time that we are believing it, we are accepting it, we're learning. My hope is that for many of you and for us, that we can take on what Peter says in his letter. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you don't see him now, you believe in him and are filled with a glorious joy. How many of you have actually physically seen Jesus, the Son of God? Well, that's a silly question, but the writer of Hebrews tells us what faith is. It's believing in things not seen. But even though we may not physically have seen the physical person of Jesus, we still love him, do we not? We're still appreciative of who he is. We still believe in his saving grace. We still believe in who he is and who he says he is. To the point that we've given our life to him. Why is all this important? Because at one point in time, we have made that choice. We have made the choice to accept Christ as our Lord and Savior. Because of that choice, we have been part of a church. And as being part of a church, we know we have a responsibility. The sad reality is that many people, many Christians, we view church as nothing more than a social club or something to belong to. You know, I'm a card-carrying member of First Christian Church. That way, you know, it may help me if I get in trouble. As silly as that sounds, there's a lot of way how people treat church. They go and they want to be taken care of. They want to be entertained. And that's their perspective. I'm here to say to you, That is not the church that Jesus Christ found. Jesus found the church that is within each and every one of us. I care for you. I care for you and your family. I mentioned earlier. You can believe me or you can't, or you won't. But I have prayed for you and your family specifically on numerous occasions, all because I care. Nothing more than that. And it's not bragging. It's just being upfront. It's just being real. It's just being honest. With that being said, I would like to thank everyone for everything you've done for Christ Church, both in the past, or in the past and in the present. But I also want to thank you for the future. Your giving, your service is much appreciated. But without your gifts and talents, the ministry of First Christian, the ministry of God's church, is not possible. But I firmly believe God has led me to reach out to you today. And God will lay that same responsibility on your heart as well, for those that you love and that you care about. We have been blessed to be part of a church, and we are blessed to have the opportunity to share that with others. I firmly believe that God has a big vision for us and for our church. And God has blessed us with a strong passion for His church and for His people. So, I would like to formally invite you, even though some of you have already invited, to be a part of the movement at First Christian. Over the next few weeks, I'll be constantly asking for this commitment. Now, I'm just asking, are you willing to commit? We're going to pursue this from Easter 2016 till Easter 2017. Let's make a difference. Let's work together and share something special. The message of Jesus Christ. But the apostles 2,000 years ago had that same message, and now billions of people over the history of, from that point forward, have come to know the Lord. And you know what? There are thousands in our county right here today that need that same message. And we could sit there and play church, come on 10:45 and have worship, and then go home. Or we could be part of a movement that will make a difference. Two of the kind of cool things that has happened to us since we had Anderson about 5 weeks ago. And for those of you who have kids, you'll automatically understand where I'm coming from. One of the cool things that we've been able to do is share him with people. Now that seems kind of obvious, but one of the most precious moments in the hospital is when my parents and her parents got to see him for the first time. And from that point on, we've had several encounters where friends of ours and family members that we truly love and care for have met him. And just to see him for the first time, they know our history. They know for 3 years that it was not really much of a possibility to have kids. And we faced that going to high-risk doctor after high-risk doctor, trying to figure out, is this even a possibility? And having that opportunity to share him has been something very, very precious. Yesterday, two of my close friends from college came to the house and got to meet him for the first time. And one of their little boys was absolutely in love with our five-week-old. I don't know why, but he was absolutely in love. And he kept kissing him. And then we told him, germs and stuff like that, but that didn't do anything. He was two. And he asked his parents if he could take Anderson home. So we told him no. As he's back there this morning. But sharing good news, sharing something cool with somebody is exciting. So what can be more exciting than sharing the good news of Jesus Christ? Sharing the fact that I get to go to heaven instead of hell. What can be more exciting than that? We have a responsibility to share that message. But we have to care for one another. We also have to care for his church. In Mark 10, 25 through 31, it says this in another kind of story that Jesus tells, or parable that Jesus talks about here. Starting in verse 25, it says this: "It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter into the kingdom of God." First, he just says it's easier for a camel, we all know the size of a camel, and the eye of a needle, for a camel to walk through that than for someone to buy their way into heaven. That's what he's saying. So make sure we understand, in order for someone to buy their way or think that they have the money and the influence to get to heaven, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle. So they even more astonished, saying to one another, then who can be saved? Look at them, Jesus said, with men it is impossible, but with God, because all things are possible with God. Peter began to tell them, look, we have left everything and followed you. I assure you, Jesus said, there is no one who has left a house, brothers, sisters, mother, father, children, or fields, because of me and the gospel, will not receive 100 times more now at this time. Houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, fields with persecution, and eternal life in the age to come. But many of you who are first will be last, and the last will be first. Jesus talks about it in this passage. He talks about perspective. And the perspective that he's battling with is the fact that they believed, firmly believed, that if someone was wealthy and successful, that meant they were blessed by God. Well, that's just their material mind working, and the fact of putting so much stock in the physical world. But they believed that somebody had those capacities, had those capabilities, it was because God blessed them. Jesus debunks that immediately. He says, no, that's not how it goes. You know, first of all, my priorities are different than your priorities. And Jesus goes on to explain heavenly priorities versus earthly priorities. The heavenly priorities are God's priorities. What God expects from us, what God wants from us. That even though we are not going to be rich, we're not going to be wealthy, that we will be blessed because of our faithfulness to God and His church. That's what Christ is driving home. But what He wants to eliminate is you're not going to be necessarily blessed financially. You're not going to necessarily be blessed with a beautiful home. But you'll be blessed in other rewards. An example is someone who is rejected by their family can find a family in church. They're blessed beyond the wildest imagination. But it was because they had to give something else up. Jesus explained that when heaven comes around, this success, this desire to be on top of the world is not going to work. Humility is what's going to be great in heaven. There's a corrupt condition of society that encourages value. You are valued by the bank account that you have. You are valued by the home that you have. You are valued by the car that you drive. And that is what's of value. But Christ says, no, those things don't matter. What matters is, if you're faithful to me, I will bless you. I will bless you with people that you care about. I will bless you with opportunity to share. I will bless you with eternal life. Now, what could you want more in this life than heaven? What would you sacrifice eternal joy for in heaven with God that's here on this earth? There's nothing worth that. Yet, we constantly tell God that there are things worth it. And we constantly put other things before God. When we constantly pick God lower and lower on the priority list. Is it worth it? I don't believe it is. I don't believe there's anything worth sacrificing heaven for. With that being said, I want to encourage you to have that same perspective. Nothing is worth giving up heaven for. And there's nothing that should stop us from sharing heaven with somebody else. That's what the movement's about. The movement is following through the Great Commission, Matthew 28:18-20. And right before Christ ascended into heaven, he said, go make disciples. Go make disciples. Continue to teach them. Continue to encourage them to grow. And I will always be with you. There's three things here. We're to love and encourage one another as we grow spiritually. We're to serve his church and take care of his kingdom. And the way we do that is not only encouraging one another and supporting one another and helping one another grow, but we add others to our church. That's a huge responsibility, but it's a responsibility that we have. It's what Christ said before he went into heaven. As he said, I'll go to prepare a place for you. He said this. How serious are we going to take it? And the movement is striving to communicate with all members and attenders of FCC. I want you guys to be part of our family. I want you to be part of our church. The movement is also adding families to First Christian. We all have people in our lives that, for whatever reason, no longer attend church. Don't automatically think these are people who aren't Christians. Many of them are. But for whatever reason, they have fallen away. They have gotten busy. Church is no longer a priority. And they need encouragement back. They need more than just one or two people saying, encouraging them to go to church, encouraging them to get plugged in. And we need to grow spiritually as individuals. I think that's so important. So what am I asking of you? When we talk about the movement, what am I asking of you? Every week, I am giving you a message, and you will receive this message. When you receive it, there's three reasons why you're receiving it. The first one is, I'm communicating to you, and I care about you enough that I want you to be part of our church. I love you enough that I want to see Christ work in you in an amazing way. That's the first thing. The second is I'm asking for prayer. Whatever event we're going to be planning in the future, you receive a message about it. I want you to be part of it, but I want you to be praying for it too. Anything worth pursuing in Christ's kingdom is not worth it if prayer is not involved. So I ask for prayer. And finally, the last one is, again, we have a responsibility to promote God's church. So that last one is after we've communicated, because I want you to be a part of our church. I want you to be part of what we're doing. I also want you to ask for your prayers. Finally, use the message to invite someone who doesn't know Christ. Examine your life. Take a look at everything. Take a look at every item and see who needs a message to be here. If you didn't grab this on your way in, we'll be at the door, so please, please, please grab them on the way out. And that is, this is the movement, just explaining it to you. Because you can say here, as we're here this morning, you can hear the message about the movement, what it's about. But I don't know about you, but I could sit here and hear somebody preach or lecture and enjoy it and get certain things out. And I'm going to walk away thinking I should have wrote that down, or I wish I had a better understanding of what this is. This is so that you don't have to do that. You can write notes, of course, but this is so you don't have to do that, so you can take it with you. It explains what it is, explains what we're asking, and it's encouraging you to be a part of it. On the back page, there's a little pink box. It's pink, so it sticks out. This is the message that I want you to be praying about, that I want you to be thinking about, that I want you to ask God to lead you with, to invite somebody to be here Easter weekend. It has a list of things of our service times, has a list of what we're doing Easter weekend. Use this. What's better than a group of people coming together and following God's vision for their life? God will bless it. We're committing to it for a year. You can do anything for a year. We're committing to it for a year. But the first message is back here. I'm going to ask you to message me if you want to be a part of the movement. Quite frankly, some of you, I'm going to draft, so you might as well say, all right, I'll do it. And if I draft you and you're like, Anthony, I don't want to have any part of this, then I'll still send it to you and I'll just pray that God changes your mind. So use this. Let's take the Great Commission seriously. Let's take what we're trying to do seriously. And my last slide that I'm going to have, and I won't skip to it yet, I'll have means to communicate with me if you're just telling me I want to be part of the movement. I do want to encourage you to do that, even if you know you're going to be drafted. I still want to encourage you to at least give you the opportunity to say yes. But I'll have that contact information at the end. You can write it down. We're just following what God wants our church to be, and I want you to be a part of that. It's easy for us for those of us who have had a relationship with Christ, to say that we'll endure anything for Christ because we love Him so much. It's easy to say that. Yet how many times are we complaining over the most minor of issues? We say we're willing to suffer on Christ on a large scale, but how many of us are really willing to serve Christ? How many of us are really willing to say, okay, I'll do it? I presented you with a plan today to serve Christ to the best of our ability and to adapt this as part of our vision and part of your vision for your life. And if you're holding back, please pray that God will use you in another capacity, because we want you to be a part of this. We want to make a difference. So if you say you're willing to do whatever you need for Christ, this is an opportunity to follow through with it. Mark 10:42-45 is another passage, and it just gives us the idea of what the kingdom of God should be about. Unfortunately, it hasn't become that, but that's what the church should be about. This is what the church should be about. Jesus called them over and said, "You know that those who are regarded as ruler of the Gentiles dominate them, and the men of high positions exercise power over them. But it must not be like that among you. On the contrary, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first among you must be a slave to all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." One thing I want to challenge you with this thinking is Jesus really gives it to James and John because they have a wrong perspective. They want to have this high position in the Lord's army, the Lord's military, the Lord's church. They want to have high personal achievement. It's easy for us to sit there and say shame on them, but it's legit, is it not? A lot of people want great things for their kids. A lot of people want great things for themselves. And high personal achievement is not necessarily a bad thing. So I don't want us to automatically attack James and John for having those feelings because, you know, who can blame them? They just wanted to make good decisions and make a good life for themselves. The problem was their thinking was in the wrong place and it wasn't appropriate with Christ. Christ just corrects the teaching. He doesn't kick them out, he doesn't really bail them out. He just tells them, hey, look, you know, we need to change this. Because you think personal achievement is what's going to make you great in Christ's church. But Christ is telling them, that's not what's going to work. It's becoming a servant. It's working alongside several servants. It's working hard to reach out and follow my mission, my ministry. And it's a beautiful point that he makes. And like I said, he doesn't just really give it to them. He just corrects their idea. So why do you go to church? Well, we go to church because we need to learn. We go to church because we need to worship. We need to lead others to Christ. We need Christ ourselves, and we need each other. It's a good idea to serve God. It's a good idea to be part of a church that serves God. But countless people, they go to church after church after church, constantly looking for a church that is going to take care of them, that wants to take care of their needs and wants. There's a problem with that thinking. It's not godly. We need to be a part of a church that wants to work together to accomplish God's vision, not ours, to accomplish God's vision. And it's easy to sit there and say, well, I'm looking for a church that's going to have this, that, and this, and that, this, and that, and I just want to sit back and be taken care of. Well, you know, you understand how prideful and arrogant that sounds. I just want to sit back and want everybody to take care of me. That's not being a Christian. That's just checking off the list. I went to church today, and I've been to church 2 or 3 times this month. I'm doing really good. You know, that must mean I'll have a special place in heaven. That's not how it works. That's not how heaven works. God wants you to be part of His family and do whatever it takes to grow His family and to reach as many people, as many creations that He has created as we possibly can. That's why I'm so passionate about this movement, because it's striving to grow spiritually through educating one another, each other, through adding families, and to just be a part of something that's accomplishing God's vision. This is in your panel. I want to invite you to a couple mission movement sessions that we're going to look at growing spiritually as individuals, and we'll look at growing spiritually as a church. These sessions will be March 27th. It is in the program. April 17th, April 24th, May 1st. There is a correction. That's actually May 22nd. This will be, we'll meet at 9:45 here at the Sensible Hour. A brief meeting will not be entailed. What's going to entail is we're going to be a 15-minute session followed by a discussion time. Those who are already part of a Sunday school class will be dismissed from their Sunday school class to have their discussion time. Those who aren't, I will lead that session, and we will spend time just trying to grow as individuals as God has intended for us, and to grow as a church that God, again, has intended for us. We're all doing this because what we want, deep down, all of us Christians want this. We want to please God. And we want to put Him first in our life. Because if He's first in our life, we're going to have a better relationship with our spouse. We're going to have a better relationship with our kids. We're going to have a better relationship with our friends, our family members. That has to be in our order. That's what we're going to be pursuing. That's what we're going to take a look at. So I encourage you to be part of the movement. The next 3 weeks, I'm going to ask for you to respond to the communication that I'm going to throw up on the screen at the end of the service. It's pursuing what Jesus wants. And this is, Jesus wants this from us. He desires total dedication, not some half-hearted commitment. We can't follow Jesus selectively, just picking and choosing what we do. We have to accept the cross along the crown, judgment as well as mercy. We must count the cost, being willing to abandon everything else that has given us security. In other words, getting out of our comfort zone. With our focus on Jesus, if we allow, should allow nothing to distract us from the ultimate goal, and that is for us to be with Him forever, everlasting life in Him in heaven, and for us to lead those we really love and care about to the same possibility, the same opportunity. We are called to be more than just ourselves. We are called to come together and be the movement. As we conclude, and I ask the musicians to come forward, we care more. I care for you and your family. We should care for our church and for God's church to be successful and become effective. And we need to have a love, a passion, and a desire to see those who don't know Christ being led to Him. It's all possible by the miracle. Contact information is up there. The next 3 weeks, I'm going to ask you to be part of the movement. Send me a text. Send me a message on Facebook if that's the place you'd rather receive the messages weekly. So you can receive them via text, through Facebook, through email. We will have them, maybe not every Sunday, but we will have them oftentimes in the bulletin or an insert. So that's a way you can receive it if you would like to rather send a card, whatever. But pray that God will use you in a mighty way. The way the Holy Spirit works, because sometimes that's confusing for us, is the Holy Spirit works through people. When you stop the Holy Spirit working is when we as Christians say no. When we as Christians say, I'm not going to follow His lead. Holy Spirit's moving today. He's tugging at your heart. He's leading you. Say yes. Don't put it off out of fear. Don't put it off out of fear of being uncomfortable, but embrace it. As we enter to these final moments of worship, we are faced with decisions. And maybe your decision is to become a Christian and give your life to the Lord and be baptized here this morning. You can come forward, we'll baptize you here this morning, and you can start your journey. Maybe you just would like, are looking for a home church and you would like to be a part of this one. We would love to have you as part of our home church. We really would. And to have you be part of the movement and be part of what we're trying to accomplish. Or maybe you just need prayer and encouragement. And I would love to pray with you and encourage you. It's something I enjoy, but I want to provide for you. You can come up here and I'll pray with you, or you can come up here and pray in front here, or stay where you are. But this is time for you. This is time of worship. Let's stand as we worship.
Okay.
guys are dismissed.
Jesus, draw me ever nearer as I labor through the storm. You have called me to this passage.